Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Perfect Unity, a guide for Christian doctrine and life by Ralph Cunnington, narrated by Mike Lenz. Forward. I love Ralph's new book, period. Let's start right there. It is now my favorite introduction to the God of the Bible, overview of the unfolding story the Bible tells, and exploration of the riches and implications of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It is accessible, timely, and intelligent. It is rooted in historical orthodoxy and is as current as the challenges of our day. And somehow, Ralph was able to pull all that off in this book. Even if I didn't share a treasured friendship with Ralph and had simply discovered his new book online or in a friend's home, the title Perfect Unity would have instantly piqued my interest. In an age of divisiveness, enmity, and strife, even semi-healthy expressions of unity are desperately needed. And though the concept of perfect unity seems implausible, as a Christian, I am wired for hope. So the title rocks. But the subtitle is just as compelling to me personally, maybe even more so. As someone who has been directionally impaired all my life, the word guide brings me comfort, especially when it's connected to matters of faith and life. I discovered a long time ago that there's nothing more than the gospel, just more of the gospel. So I'm always ready to be guided into a greater understanding and experience of the faith delivered once for all to the saints. Jude chapter 1, verse 3. But as awesome as the title of Ralph's book may be, the title is number 5 on the top 5 list of reasons I am excited and grateful for this new book. Before I ever turned one page of Ralph's manuscript, I experienced the reality that generated the sentences, paragraphs, and chapters of this wonderful book. Indeed, I saw, smelled, and tasted this book before I read it. I witnessed organic reality before I interacted with my friend's thoughts on paper. It's impossible for me to overstate how important of a gift this is to me. I have had the privilege of both visiting and ministering in City Church Manchester, where Ralph serves as lead pastor. Nothing narrated in this book is abstract theory, but is rather gospel reality in the making. It's a lot easier to write an aspirational book about unity than chronicle God's work in creating palpable unity in your own highly diverse church family. Ralph has a well-trained mind, but he also has a grace-trained palate, savoring the present reality of God's kingdom while he hungers for the fullness of the kingdom. It shows up in his pastoring and his writing. Indeed, I thank God for City Church, a community that demonstrates that unity isn't uniformity, a big group hug and the absence of conflict. Unity is the blending, not homogenizing, of the grand diversity we enjoy as image bearers of God. Ralph's book teaches us that this unity is grounded in the greatness, oneness, and diversity of God Himself, as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and is brought to life by the person and work of Jesus and the present ministry of the Holy Spirit. As I read Perfect Unity, it increasingly felt as though I were enjoying a musical score. This book sings as much as it informs. It doesn't just present the truth, but also opens the curtains on the goodness and beauty of our God and His glorious gospel. Thank you, Ralph. Thank you, my dear friend, brother, and colleague in gospel wonder. Your church family, heart, book, and title all rock. Scotty Smith, Franklin, Tennessee. Introduction. John Lennon urged us to imagine. Imagine a world where there are no countries, where we all live in peace, where we all live as one. I find that vision pretty appealing. I love the idea of the world and all its beautiful diversity being united, each part playing its role, retaining its unique features while contributing to the one unified whole. But as I look around, I see a world rife with division. There is conflict between countries and conflict within countries. Despots order their armies to commit atrocious acts in order to realign ancient boundaries. Neighbors and family members turn against one another as they align themselves with different group identities that are defined by what they oppose. It is ugly, and it is sad. We yearn for the sort of oneness that Lenin describes, but it seems tantalizingly elusive. Is there any hope? Lenin's answer, in his song Imagine, is an atheistic utopia that channels Marx and Engels' Communist Manifesto, a place where there is no heaven, hell, or religion. For many people, this may sound persuasive. After all, religion has been at the root of many of the world's worst conflicts. Whether it be the hostility between Shia and Sunni Muslims in the Middle East, the tragic complicity of the Protestant Church in the African slave trade, or the marginalization of same-sex-attracted people by the church, the role of religion in dividing us is undeniable. It is misguided, however, to assume that the solution to division on earth is simply to remove religion and replace it with a form of philosophical naturalism. Indeed, the nihilism that Lenin proposes fails both to accurately diagnose the problem and to offer a viable solution. Let's start with the problem, which we can observe on both an individual and a societal level. As individuals, we encounter a curious paradox. We fear difference, and yet we are strangely drawn to it. I see that in my marriage. Anna and I are a prime example of the saying, opposites attract. Our personalities, interests, love languages, and approaches to conflict are all at opposite ends of the spectrum. And that is one of the things that so attracts us to one another. Yet, at times, it is also a source of fear, because differences expose. Engaging with someone who is different from you shines a light on your personality, assumptions, culture, and desires. Because it can be profoundly unsettling, it often makes us yearn for an echo chamber, for people who are just like us. We also see these impulses in relations between people of different ethnicities. Initially, we may find it intriguing to learn about other people's languages, customs, histories, and cuisines. But before long, we become uncomfortable as our assumptions are challenged and the views we hold strongly are exposed as culturally formed preferences. We see the same dynamic at work in society. In the 1970s, multiculturalism was a settled government policy in the United Kingdom. It was seen as the best way to accommodate the significant increase in post-war immigration. The government assumed that communities would be able to live side by side without adapting any of their cultures, languages, or customs. More recently, however, this approach has been called into question. The inability of communities to peacefully coexist, along with real concerns about what some groups believe, has resulted in greater opposition to multiculturalism. The former head of the Commission for Racial Equality, Trevor Phillips, stated that multiculturalism suggests separateness, and that the UK needs a more unifying and homogeneous culture with common values, the common currency of the English language, honoring the culture of these islands, like Shakespeare and Dickens. This is a controversial topic, and multiculturalism is a notoriously difficult concept to define. But it highlights the uncomfortable truth that diversity is both attractive and repellent, beautiful and unsettling. Why is that so? John Lennon's musings in Imagine fail to make sense of the problem. His naturalistic account of the world in which we are nothing more than impersonal atoms flying around and bumping into one another does not explain why we value diversity and find it so attractive. His insistence that the problem lies with established religion overlooks its true source, our own hearts. This, of course, means that the concepts of heaven and hell cannot be so easily discarded. What is the solution? For a time, society, under the influence of modernism, sought to pursue unity by denying difference. Abraham Kuyper memorably described this as a reckless leveling and elimination of all diversity, which seeks a false, deceptive unity, the uniformity of death. Kuyper traced this tendency from the Roman Empire to the French Revolution. Blind to the rich profusion of the different shades of life, it crushes everything fresh and natural by its thirst for the conventional. He saw it in his own day, through the erosion of ethnic, cultural, and sexual distinctions. His work was remarkably prophetic and anticipated the late 20th century, in which claims to be gender blind and color blind were lauded rather than condemned. Things have changed since then. Today, society, under the influence of postmodernism, has chosen to emphasize difference rather than deny it. One manifestation of this has been the emergence of identity politics, which establishes alternating power structures in which one group oppresses the other and then is oppressed by it in turn. The background to this conceptualization of society has been historic and documented injustice, both individual and structural, that requires redress. To this extent, the motivation of many who swim in the waters of identity politics is both good and biblical. Scripture is clear that the Lord cares for the marginalized and the oppressed. See Isaiah chapter 25, verse 4, chapter 61, verses 1 through 3, Malachi chapter 3, verse 5, and that Christians should too. See Isaiah chapter 1, verse 17, Zechariah chapter 7, verses 9 through 10. The problem is that identity politics not only seeks to right historic wrongs, but also creates distance between people groups and pits them against one another. Men against women, whites against blacks, transgender people against feminists. Consistent with its postmodern underpinnings, identity politics is excellent at celebrating and even intensifying diversity, but it has no framework for establishing unity. In short, the modern approach denies the glory of diversity, while the postmodern approach denies the possibility of unity. We instinctively long for something better, true unity amid true diversity. Yet this always seems out of reach. Is there any hope? In his classic work, Mere Christianity, C.S. Lewis famously wrote, "The Christian says creatures are not born with desires unless satisfaction for those desires exists. A baby feels hunger. Well, there is such a thing as food. A duckling wants to swim. Well, there is such a thing as water. Men feel sexual desire. Well, there is such a thing as sex. If I find in myself a desire which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world. If none of my earthly pleasures satisfy it, that does not prove that the universe is a fraud. Probably earthly pleasures were never meant to satisfy it, but only to arouse it, to suggest the real thing." What if our desire for unity in diversity points beyond our observable experience to a reality that is found within God Himself? And what if this reality could become ours by being caught up into the beautiful story that Christians call the gospel? The seed of this book was planted more than a decade ago. I remember it well. Our second child, Zach, had just been born and was keeping my wife and me up at night. It was my first year at the Wales Evangelical School of Theology, now Union School of Theology, and, determined not to miss any lectures, I made my way to my 9 a.m. systematic theology class. As I took my seat, Dr. Robert Lethem announced, "These three words will stand you in good stead as you continue theological study and enter into pastoral ministry. They will guard you against theological heterodoxy." He had our attention. We sat on the edge of our seats, waiting for this piece of theological gold dust that would both guarantee our course grade and give us a solid foundation for pastoral ministry. Looking at us intently, Dr. Lethem spoke the three words: distinct but inseparable. It's fair to say that the class was underwhelmed. We had expected something far more profound, more radical. But as the years have gone by, I've become convinced that Dr. Lethem was absolutely right. I quickly realized that the phrase was not original to him. It was first formulated by 4th century theologian Augustine, as he sought to articulate an orthodox understanding of the Trinity. It was picked up again in the 5th century by the Council of Chalcedon, as it sought to explain the relationship between Christ's human nature and his divine nature. A question began to form in my mind. Was it a mere coincidence that the phrase used to describe the nature of God as Trinity was also used to describe the union of natures that lies at the heart of the Incarnation? I quickly realized that it wasn't. Humanity was created in the image of God. See Genesis chapter 1, verse 26. As we shall discuss, this is an intensely relational concept with implications both for our vertical relationship with God and for our horizontal relationships with one another. Dutch Reformed theologian Herman Bavinck wrote, "The Trinity reveals God to us as the fullness of being, the true life, eternal beauty. In God, there is unity in diversity, and diversity in unity." Unity in diversity, and diversity in unity, is the template for all other relationships in the universe. Contrary to our instincts, unity is founded not on homogeneity, parties being identical, but rather on a union of diverse parties. Human sin has corrupted the unity in diversity that should be present throughout God's creation. And the good news of the gospel is that God has restored this unity in diversity. Accordingly, the phrase distinct but inseparable has a crucial role to play in helping us understand who God is, who we are, how we have been redeemed, and where we are heading. That is the focus of this book. In part one, we will begin by exploring who God is. We will discover that He is one God who has eternally existed in three distinct but inseparable persons. This is what Bavinck meant when he wrote that in God there is unity in diversity and diversity in unity. This provides the essential framework for rightly understanding the unity in diversity that we see in the world around us and the strong desire we have for relationships with people who are unlike us. In part two, we will discover how the distinct yet inseparable relationship between God and humanity was ruined by the fall. This relationship was restored by God the Son, as He assumed a human nature, distinct yet inseparable from His divine nature, which has enabled us to worship God again, distinct yet inseparable from Him. Part 3 looks at the big picture of what God is doing in the world. It walks through the various views of how God relates to the world He has made and shows that the Bible teaches both God's sovereignty and humanity's responsibility. The relationship between these two truths is notoriously tricky to articulate, but I will demonstrate how the language of distinct but inseparable provides the necessary framework for understanding God's sovereignty in the world. Moreover, I will reveal how this doctrine is derived from God's own being, which is both transcendent and immanent. In part four, we will consider Christian identity. Who are we as Christians? I will answer this question against the backdrop of current debates about identity. We will learn that Christians have both an external, given identity, justification and adoption, and an internal, emerging identity, sanctification. These three gifts of salvation are received distinctly but inseparably through our union with Christ and are therefore both fixed and assured. Part 5 explores how we grow in the Christian life. It focuses on the ancient yet often forgotten truth that the means of grace, the preaching of the Word and the sacraments, are the spiritual greenhouse of the Christian life. Christians sometimes wonder whether spiritual growth ought to be automatic whenever we use the means of grace. We will see that the phrase distinct but inseparable helps us to appreciate how the Holy Spirit uses the means of grace and encourages us to approach them confidently and expectantly. In the final part of this book, we will seek to apply what we have learned to the church. These are tumultuous times in which the church is being rocked by debates surrounding gender, ethnicity, and identity politics. Many Christians struggle to provide a winsome and plausible response. We will see that the church has always had the conceptual framework to respond faithfully and persuasively to the current challenges. We have just forgotten about it. The distinction without separation that we see within the Godhead and within the gospel is essential to understanding the church. We are one church of many gifts, one church of two genders, and one church of all nations. I am passionate about this book because I believe its central message is of profound importance to the church today. I ought to acknowledge, though, that it discusses extremely sensitive topics, topics that will touch each of us in different ways. I serve on a church staff where both of my co-pastors experienced racist bullying at school, and where my American colleague lived under the oppression of racial segregation in the United States for many years. My stepmother grew up in an internment camp set up by British colonial authorities to put down the Mau Mau Rebellion in Kenya. Though I have not experienced ethnic or sexual discrimination firsthand, I care deeply about it. The wonderful message of this book is that one day, all discrimination will end. As we await that day, we are called to glorify God as His unified, diverse church. Part 1. Who is God? I still remember the first time I asked a Christian to explain the doctrine of the Trinity. I wasn't yet a believer, but I was genuinely interested in learning more. The poor girl looked at me as if I'd asked her how many angels can dance on a pinhead. She replied, somewhat apologetically, "I don't really know. It's one of the mysteries of the Christian faith." That didn't sound satisfactory to me. If the God who Christians worship is triune, then surely there should be something more to say about Him than, "It's just one big mystery, like in Scooby-Doo." During membership classes at City Church, I often ask questions about the theological truths we profess. One of the questions I like to ask is, why is the doctrine of the Trinity important? I hear lots of great answers. The doctrine enables God to be love within Himself. It shows how He is relational in His very essence. It provides the basis for unity and diversity within the world He has created. All of those things are wonderfully true, and we will discuss them later. But they are the consequences of the doctrine of the Trinity, not the doctrine itself. The reason why the doctrine of the Trinity is important, the fundamental reason, is that it describes who God is. But how much can we know about God? Is it reasonable to think that we can explain the Trinity? Surely the girl was right to say that the nature of God is a mystery. He is infinite, after all, and we are finite. Isn't it ridiculous to imagine that we can understand Him? Now is the time to consider two words that describe the different degrees to which we know things. The first word is comprehension. To comprehend something is to know absolutely everything there is to know about it. In truth, human beings do not comprehend anything. The second way in which we know things is through apprehension. We apprehend something when we know true things about it without knowing it exhaustively. I spent 7 years teaching commercial law at university. During that time, I apprehended commercial law. That is to say, I knew lots of true things about the subject without knowing it exhaustively. Did my lack of exhaustive knowledge exclude me from teaching? Of course not. Some argue that we cannot truly know God because we cannot know Him exhaustively. But that is flawed logic. There are lots of things about which we have real, true knowledge, but not exhaustive knowledge. In fact, that is the way we relate to the vast majority of things in our world, including our job, our parents, our spouse, and our children. We know them and want to know them better, even though we cannot know them exhaustively. With this in mind, and acknowledging that we cannot know everything there is to know about the Trinity, we will examine what we do know about the Trinity in Chapter 1. 1. One God in Three Persons. The God of the Bible is one God who has eternally existed as three persons. Ultimate beauty is found in the God who is three in one. The Bible's teaching on the doctrine of the Trinity can be summarized by three key statements. 1. God is one. 2. God has eternally existed in three persons. 3. Each person of the Trinity is fully God. God is one. The Bible repeatedly declares that there is one true God. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 reads, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." The Israelites are then told to impress the commandments of this one true God on their children, talking about them when they sit at home and when they walk along the road, when they go to bed and when they rise. See Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 7. This affirmation of faith in the one true God is repeated throughout the Old Testament. In Isaiah chapter 44, verses 6 through 7, we read, "This is what the Lord says, Israel's King and Redeemer, the Lord Almighty. I am the first and I am the last. Apart from me, there is no God. Who then is like me? Let him proclaim it." In the New Testament, the Apostle Paul writes, "There is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus." 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. At first glance, these repeated claims that the Lord is God and there is no other may sound horribly exclusive. Contemporary Western society claims to be pluralistic. Hindus have their gods, Muslims have Allah, Jews have Yahweh, Sikhs have Wahguru. Many believe that this acceptance of any and all gods furthers the much-promoted goals of tolerance and inclusivity in our society. However, we must understand that the multiplicity of gods is what divided the peoples of the ancient Near East. The Moabites worshipped Chemosh, the Ammonites worshipped Milcom, and the Edomites worshipped Quas. These were territorial gods who, their followers claimed, provided protection in return for sacrifices. The gods were tied to particular people in particular places. They were exclusive. The God of the Bible is inclusive. Because he is the one true God, he is everyone's God, without exception or qualification. After writing that there is one God and one mediator between God and mankind, the man Christ Jesus, Paul writes that Jesus gave himself as a ransom for all people. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 5 and 6. Because God is one, his Savior is a Savior for all who believe. See Romans chapter 1, verse 16. Without exception. This is radical inclusivism. God has eternally existed as three persons. Some assume that the doctrine of the Trinity is taught only in the New Testament, or even worse, that it was invented by the Council of Nicaea in the 4th century AD. This was the famous claim of Dan Brown in the Da Vinci Code. That would be shocking if God has indeed eternally existed as Trinity. However, when you dig into the Old Testament, you quickly discover abundant evidence of plurality within God. We can start in the very first chapter of the Bible. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 reads, "Then God said, 'Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness.'" Notice that the verse includes a plural verb, "let us," and a plural noun, "our." What is the significance of this? It's possible that God is using the royal "we," much as the King of England might say, "We are not impressed by your poor taste in music." The problem is that there are no other examples of the royal "we" in Hebrew literature. Alternatively, God may be speaking with other beings, such as the angels, as he creates, but that would make these other beings co-creators with God. There is no evidence for this elsewhere in the Bible. The third, and most plausible option, is that this is the earliest evidence of plurality within God. We see something similar in Isaiah chapter 6. The prophet Isaiah sees the Lord seated on a throne in the temple. Angels are all around him. And we read in verse 8, "Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, 'Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?'" Note that God uses both singular and plural pronouns here. "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" This is significant evidence of both the unity and plurality within God himself. There are many more Old Testament passages we could examine, but Psalm 110 is probably the best known, not least because Jesus quotes it in Mark chapter 12, verses 36 through 37. In verse 1 of the psalm, David writes, "The Lord says to my Lord, 'Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet.'" The question is, Who is David referring to when he speaks of two lords? It seems clear that the first Lord is Yahweh. That's why our English translations capitalize the word Lord. But who is the second Lord? David is writing as the king of Israel, and he has no Lord other than God. Yet, the second Lord is clearly distinct from Yahweh and is given a place at Yahweh's right hand, which is suitable only for one who is himself God. Here again is evidence of the plurality of God. One who is a son of David, yet the Lord of David, as Jesus notes in Mark chapter 12, verse 37. While God's eternal existence as three persons is visible in the Old Testament, it comes to the fore in the New. At Jesus' baptism, we see God the Holy Spirit descend on Jesus like a dove, while the voice of God the Father declares from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." Mark chapter 1, verse 11. All three persons of the Trinity are active. Some of the most well-known verses in the Bible contain a triadic formula whereby the names of all three persons of the Trinity are invoked. Perhaps the most famous is the Great Commission, in which Jesus commands his disciples to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. Almost equally well known, and probably repeated more often in church life, is the grace or benediction found at the end of Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 14. Each of these verses invokes the names of all three persons of the Trinity. Each person of the Trinity is fully God. The third truth that the Bible teaches is that each person of the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is fully God. This was challenged in the 3rd and 4th centuries by a theologian named Arius, who argued that the Son had a beginning, and therefore that there was a time when he did not exist. As such, he saw the Son as the highest of all created beings, an angel, but not God himself. The Church condemned this view as inconsistent with Scripture and with what the Church had taught from its earliest days. Let's look briefly at the New Testament evidence. Throughout his Gospel, Mark records Jesus doing numerous things that only God can do. On his own authority, Jesus cast out demons, chapter 1, verses 25 through 26, chapter 3, verses 23 through 29, forgave sins, chapter 2, verses 1 through 12, calmed a storm, chapter 4, verses 35 through 41, and raised a young girl from the dead, chapter 5, verses 21 through 43. The teachers of the law clearly understood the implication of his actions, asking, "Why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Mark chapter 2, verse 7. The crowning moment of Mark's gospel comes in chapter 15, verse 39, when a battle-hardened Roman centurion declares, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Likewise, John's gospel is full of claims that Jesus is God, both from Jesus himself and from others. The book opens with the declaration, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." John chapter 1, verse 1. Later, in verse 14, the Word is identified as the one who became flesh, Jesus. Now, Jehovah's Witnesses, modern-day Arians who deny that Jesus is God, point out that the definite article, "the," is missing at the end of John chapter 1, verse 1. So they translate the verse, "In the beginning was the Word," and "the Word was with God," and "the Word was a God," New World Translation. This is a mistake. It is not uncommon for the definite article to be omitted in New Testament Greek, and the reason for doing so here is quite clear. John has just described how the Word was with God, the Father, in the beginning. He thus emphasizes their distinction and their relationship. In the third part of the sentence, he wants to show that the Word is divine, but not identical with the Father. And so he drops the definite article. He is saying, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with the God, the Father, and the Word was God. In so doing, he shows that the Word is distinct from the Father and yet equally God. There are numerous confirmations of Jesus' deity throughout John's Gospel. For example, there are 7 I Am statements. Jesus says, I am the bread of life, chapter 6, verse 35. I am the light of the world, chapter 8, verse 12. I am the gate, chapter 10, verse 7. I am the good shepherd, chapter 10, verses 11 and 14. I am the resurrection and the life, chapter 11, verse 25. I am the way and the truth and the life, chapter 14, verse 6. And I am the true vine, chapter 15, verse 1. These were incredibly provocative sayings because in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, God identifies himself to Moses as, I am who I am. From that point on, this phrase became a way to relate with God personally and to say that God is the same today, yesterday, and forever. By using the phrase so often, Jesus unequivocally identifies himself as God. His Jewish listeners certainly understood it that way, as it led them to pick up stones in order to stone him. See John chapter 8, verse 59. In John's Gospel, Jesus is charged with making himself equal with God, chapter 5, verse 18, and claiming to be God, see chapter 10, verse 33. In his high priestly prayer, Jesus declares, And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began, chapter 17, verse 5. The climax of John's Gospel comes when Jesus invites Thomas to touch his hands and his side, after which Thomas exclaims, My Lord and my God. Chapter 20, verse 28. In addition to the evidence for the Son's deity in the Gospel accounts, there are numerous texts that affirm his deity elsewhere in the New Testament. In Romans chapter 9, verse 5, the Apostle Paul expressly identifies Jesus as God over all, forever praised. And in Titus chapter 2, verse 13, he describes Jesus as our great God and Savior. The author of Hebrews identifies Jesus as God when he applies Psalm 45, verse 6 to him. Your throne, O God, will last forever and ever. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8. And Peter does something similar when he applies Isaiah chapter 8, verses 12 through 13 to Jesus in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 14 through 15. The deity of the Holy Spirit is assumed throughout the Bible, but made explicit in a number of places. The triadic formulas that we have examined place the Son and the Holy Spirit alongside God the Father. It would be absurd to baptize people in the name of the Son and the Spirit if the Son and the Spirit were somehow of a lower order than God the Father. People would simply be baptized in the name of the Father, as he alone would be God. Perhaps the most significant passage for establishing the full deity and personhood of the Holy Spirit is Acts chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. It is a sad and sordid tale. Having seen believers in Jerusalem sell their property and give the proceeds to the poor, Ananias and Sapphira feel, presumably out of a desire to keep up with the Joneses, that they ought to do the same. But their hearts aren't really in it. They want to be seen as generous, but they're not willing to give away everything they receive. So they sell a piece of property, but hold back some of the money, giving the rest to the apostles while claiming that they gave it all. See Acts chapter 5, verse 2. The apostle Peter's response is significant. Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you have lied to the Holy Spirit and have kept for yourself some of the money you received for the land? Chapter 5, verse 3. Peter continues, What made you think of doing such a thing? You have not lied just to human beings, but to God. Chapter 5, verse 4. Do you see what Peter has done? He has explicitly identified the Holy Spirit as God. As 19th century American theologian W.G.T. Shedd put it, The whole undivided divine nature is in each divine person simultaneously and eternally. Living it out, we worship God as three in one. Understanding that God is Trinity shapes the way we worship Him. No one has put this better than Gregory of Nazianzus, who wrote, "No sooner do I conceive of the One that I am illumined by the splendor of the Three. No sooner do I distinguish them than I am carried back to the One." As we worship, we should honor God in His triunity, as both the One and the Three. Our reflection on the Three should move us to the One, and then back to the Three, and then back to the One. This means that it is right and proper to worship each person of the Trinity as well as the whole Trinity. Some resist this idea and suggest that the Holy Spirit is the shy member of the Trinity who always deflects attention away from Himself. It is true that the Holy Spirit glorifies Jesus, see John chapter 16, verse 14, and that the ordinary pattern of prayer in Scripture is to pray to the Father, through the Son, and by the Holy Spirit. See Ephesians chapter 2, verse 18. Nevertheless, the Spirit remains fully God and worthy of our praise and worship. As John Owen writes, the Holy Spirit is an eternally existing divine substance, the author of divine operation, and the object of divine and religious worship. We worship God as three in one. The most beautiful and supreme being is one and many. Unity in diversity. Making it personal. 1. How could a deeper understanding of God as Trinity impact who you share the gospel with and how you share the gospel? 2. How should God?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.